So I'm here to talk today about a team that I started a few years ago at Google with the best logo ever. We're called the Data Liberation Front, not to be confused with the Front of Data Liberation or the People's Front of Data Liberation. Exactly. Thank you. Okay, this is going to be a good crowd. We chose this logo particularly, a few reasons. One is that what big company lets people take their data out, makes it easier for people to take their data out? We saw ourselves as revolutionaries. Turned out within Google, not very revolutionary at all. But beyond that, we wanted to evoke an emotion. We want to get people, not just technologists, to start thinking about their data as something that's not just a bunch of ones and zeros. Think about it like it's really important, because it is. Your data is very important to you. We also are into sustainability, if you're not into the revolutionary thing. But we have a very simple mission statement. We're just here to make it easier to get your data in and out of Google. Beyond that, we want to raise awareness. We want people to think more about that. So I'm going to talk a bit about why it's important to think about your data, why it's important to make sure that data isn't locked in, why it's good for business, and lastly, why we as technologists need to think more about our data and about what we're doing with data, and we need to get more people to think about it. Because actually, I think the future of our legacy of data and memories are actually somewhat in danger here if we don't move quickly. So to be clear, there's a lot of different types of data that we as a company deal with. We have data that's authenticated. We know exactly who you are. We have data that's not necessarily authenticated, tied to an IP address, which is eventually anonymized further. And then lastly, we have data that would crawl from the web, geographic data, that sort of thing. We're focused very specifically on the data that's your data, that we know exactly who you are. Now, this didn't start 4 years ago. This started a very long time ago when I graduated from college. This was my very first email address. I'm not going to give you my BitNet address. I graduated, and I probably had less email from my college career than I get in a day today. But I was really annoyed that I couldn't take that with me. Nobody thinks about sucking data out of a giant mainframe. Oh, you mean take that with you? That's so funny. But then I was moving a few years back, and I came across something like this. How many people have one of these somewhere up in a closet, right? This is really important stuff. I mean, my version of this box has pictures of my family, my grandparents, my great-grandparents in some cases. It has letters that my grandparents and my parents wrote. This is really important stuff to me. Unfortunately, it sort of sits in a closet somewhere. Can't really share it. Pull it out once every few years, flip through and be like, oh yeah, maybe I'll take something out and scan it in or that sort of thing. But where are we putting this now? Is it a good idea if we're going to have this all stored in the cloud somewhere and can't get a hold of it, or someone deletes it after 6 months because we haven't logged into somewhere? We need to think about this more and more. Now, when people find out they, at a conference or a party, I meet somebody, especially non-technologists, we're having a drink, and they say, oh, where do you work? I say, I work at Google. They say, oh my God, Google, I love how you guys changed the logo and the Pac-Man thing and the this. Do you do that? I said, no. Well, what do you do at Google? Well, I have this team called the Data Liberation Front. And what we do is, why do they care? Why should they care? They don't deal with data. They do deal with photos. They do deal with letters. They do write email, but they don't think about it that way. So I say to them, would you move into an apartment building where you couldn't move any of your furniture, clothes, or pictures, or your books out at the end of your lease? Would you lock yourself in jail voluntarily? Well, aside from you. We do this to our data all the time. We don't think twice about it. Now, I talk a lot about open. Now, and I think people confuse why Google as a company thinks openness. We talk about open source, open web, open data, all these different things. People don't have high expectations of most big companies, right? They get you as a you're a customer at a big company, and the next thing you expect is they're going to hit you with the orbital mine lasers, right? Now, I could name a lot of different companies, but I'll talk about one specific one with a big round logo that we're all very familiar with. Certainly don't expect a lot out of them. It's not about being nice, although I kind of think we are nice, at least I am. It's not about morality. Open versus closed is not a statement that I'm making of morality. The statement I'm making is that if you lock your users in, it makes you complacent. If you don't have to work as hard as you can to keep your users, you're not going to. One way to keep your users is by innovating, by making your product better. How many people here bought a 2-year contract to use Google search? How many people bought a piece of hardware just specifically for using Google search? Other than you. There's always one. You got taken, by the way. If you lock your users in, your product can be dead on the vine and you're not even going to know it. If it's easier for your users to leave, it's a way that they're going to give you a strong signal that they've had it or that they want to go somewhere else. 15 years ago, if you bought a piece of software, you'd get in your car, you'd go to the store, you'd get a box. You come home with that box, you open it up, you have 10 or 15 diskettes in it, 3.5-inch floppies probably. If you're lucky, you get a manual. You stuff all these disks in your computer, your big tower probably, rebooted 7, 8, 9 times, and you're ready to use the software, and your neighbor's kid comes over and tells you you bought the wrong software. You get back in your car, you repeat this thing. Right now, I could email or post a link on Twitter, Google+, Facebook, to a piece of software on a web. Everyone in this room could be trying it out within 2 minutes. I could talk about an app for your Android phone or your iPhone. You could download it and try it in just seconds. The cost of switching is approaching zero. The speed at which you can try new things out is faster and faster every day. Choice and trust are becoming really important. If a company wants people to try their stuff and stick with them, trust actually matters now. We've gone from a disconnected bunch of computers to a global network of distribution that's almost free. This is why the game has changed. This is why it's important to focus more on your users. Trust matters. You don't want to lock your users in further. There's a lot of different kinds of lock-in we deal with every day. Buying hardware is a type of lock-in. Training to learn a piece of software is a type of lock-in. Anybody here fly a lot? Oh boy. Frequent flyer miles, it's a type of lock-in. Do we need another kind of lock-in? I would argue that we don't. So in data liberation, we encourage people as a way of raising awareness to ask 3 questions before you use a piece of software on the web, particularly where you're putting data in. Can I get my data out in a format that somebody can do something with? If you can't get it out at all, obviously there's a no starter there. If you can get it out in some obfuscated format, governments are big fans of PDFs, we all know. Glad to see that's changing. But you need it in some sort of format that you can do something with it, or someone else can who has the technical capabilities. I would argue it shouldn't cost you anything extra to get your data out. If you're using a free service, it should be free to get your data out. If you're paying for a service, it should be included. You shouldn't have to pay to leave. Now, the last one is the tricky one. This is what most people forget about, is that time is important here. And sometimes a company might say, oh, well, you know, you can get your data out. Let's say you have a photo service, okay? Now, you can go and click each one of your photos and download and save as and blah, 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 which is great if you have 5 photos up there. That's no problem. I wouldn't mind doing that for 2 minutes. If you have 5,000 photos, you're going to have to call your boss, take the week off, and sit home clicking a mouse for 5 days. Are you really going to do that? Probably not. So when we started working on this, we went from product to product, making it easier to get data out. Blogger's a good example. Right there at the top, import blog, export blog. Delete is important. Very important element of control. Shouldn't be tied to export because sometimes I might want to take my data out to try another product, just a copy. Great thing about data is you can copy it for almost for free. Google Docs. We worked so that you can actually choose different formats for your docs and spreadsheets or whatever, PDFs, et cetera, wrap them up in a zip file and shoot them down for you. So that was good. We were pretty excited about that. But last month, we released a new product, our first official Google product called Takeout. We're pretty happy with it. And basically, it gives you a way to take your data out from multiple products at once. And we launched with a subset of our products. And our goal is to keep adding products. And I will not be happy until every last byte of your data is available through this product. Thank you. Don't get too excited. The way that we, as technologists, have thought about data up until now, specifically personal data, I would argue it's flawed. We've been very focused on implementation as opposed to what is the right thing to do. Let's think about mail. Let's say that we're going to start writing back and forth. Now, if I write you a letter and I keep a copy of that, let's say that I put carbon paper behind it and make a carbon copy. How many people here have ever seen a piece of carbon paper? More than I expected. Wow. So if I keep a copy of it and I send you a letter and you write a letter and make a copy and send it to me, and we go back and forth and correspond for a while, and after a while I decide I've had it, and I'm going to burn all my mail, my copies, your copies. It's understood that you're still going to have a copy of our correspondence. That's sort of how it works. It's an implementation of postal mail. We took this with us to email. So we can email back and forth. I automatically get a copy of my mail. You automatically keep a copy of your mail. We both have copies of everything. I decide I've had it with the internet. I haven't had it with the internet. I'm going to delete all my mail. Now, it's understood that you're still going to have copies of that. We understand that's an implementation detail. It started to get trickier when blogs started to come along. I'd write a blog post. You might comment on it. You might comment on it. I'd comment again. We'd start a big conversation. Maybe we'd be solving the world's problems in this blog post. What if I just said, oh, well, you know, somebody disagreed with me. I'm deleting my blog post. Poof. Everything disappears. What if you decide, I'm tired of trolling this guy. I'm going to delete all my comments. Oftentimes, that's possible. Is it the right thing to do? You're changing a story when there's a central copy of something stored, as opposed to people having multiple copies of it. I would argue it's an implementation detail that we've been left with. But it gets worse if we're collaboratively editing a document. Okay, so maybe it's just a few of us working on this document. Maybe it's just one person. But what if in this document, it's not just you that wrote it, but I actually helped out? Okay, I added a few sentences. I fixed a couple of typos here and there. 2 weeks later, I decide that I'm mad at you and I don't like you anymore and you're no longer my friend. Should I be able to go in there and delete just the pieces that I wrote? It's almost as if you would take a thread out of a sweater. I want my thread back, and now you have a sweater that falls apart. Is that the right thing to do? Photos get even more interesting. The example people love to use in photos is, there was a photo that someone put up of me, and I didn't want it up there, and I wanted it deleted. Well, what if there was a bunch of other people in that photo who liked the photo? What if it was just a photo of me that I really liked? Joey Ito, I had dinner with him a couple years ago, and he took this picture of me. I didn't know what the hell he was up to, but I actually kind of like this photo. I think it's sort of silly, a little bit Salvador Dali. But I've referred people to this photo all the time. Now, in the past, if someone took a photo of you liked, or a photo of something you liked, you would say, can I get a copy of that? Can you make me a print? Can I borrow the negative? Today, we just link to it. It's this central photo. Okay, it's great. What if he decides to delete it someday and I don't have a copy of it? I'd be kind of bummed. What if I have all these links on the web that are pointing to it? Suddenly, they're pointing to nothing. I think this is a problem. These arbitrary technical decisions are affecting the future story and how we control our data. Now, a lot of people will say, well, you know, we have copyright and ownership and all. That's why I don't talk about ownership and copyright, because 1,500 lawyers rappel from the ceiling and beat me to a pulp. But the fact of the matter is that copyright came into being somewhere around 1710. I don't think they knew about the internet. I don't think they wrote it saying, one day we're going to have 25 people from 15 countries writing one document. I don't think they were thinking about that. Something's going to break. We've got to think about that. We've got to start thinking about data as our possessions. Or instead of walking around wearing a sweater, we're just going to have a pile of yarn. Instead of our kids and our grandkids having a box of photos, they're going to have an empty box. Thank you very much.